Everyone's been locked up for the past few weeks. Maybe a month? Actually, more than a month? I don't know. But nonetheless, product launches still keep happening. And I think May and June are probably gonna be the busy seasons that we're about to see. So definitely stick around for some cool content because we have some in the works. But today, my friends, I wanna take a deep dive into the performance, benchmarks, and a few of the things for AMD's new Ryzen 3 3300X and 3100 processors. Now, like Dimitri mentioned in his explain video, these are not flagship CPUs, but we're all excited about them. But does a low price and some really good looking specs mean these are complete winners? Well, there are a bunch of things I wanna cover, including some concerns. First up, I need to mention that neither of these CPUs are replacing anything in AMD's current lineup. Other than a few APUs, there hasn't been a new Ryzen 3 CPU without integrated graphics since the Ryzen 3 1300X and the 1200. I mean, sure, there were a few OEM models, but those weren't available widely at retail. Now, about those concerns, well, they're pretty minor, but I want to tackle them right away. And the first is how AMD is handling this launch. It's brilliant, but also frustrating at the same time. You see, while today marks the day where we can publish all the CPU performance results, these new Ryzen CPUs won't be available until May 21st or even later. Now, sure, there might be a few batches floating around before then, just so we can't call this a paper launch, but you're gonna have to keep your eyes wide open to at least find one. What's even worse is that the B550 motherboards that everyone wants to install these new CPUs on won't be available until mid-June. So it's like you're getting your processors first and then motherboards later. There's just no logic in that. And the market's gonna look very different once the 3300X, the 3100, and the new B550 motherboards hit store shelves. And that's because Intel will have their 10th-gen CPUs, Z490 and H470 motherboards rolling out soon. It looks like Intel might finally be waking up since some of their new CPUs hit right at AMD's stronghold of offering more cores for less money. But will that actually be enough this late in the game? We'll find that out in a few weeks, I guess. And with that taken into account, you should consider this video as more of a performance preview rather than an actual review. Now, as for the specs, even though Dimitri covered these in his video, here they are again. Both the 3100 and 3300X are 4-core, 8-thread CPUs with 16 megabytes of L3 cache and TDPs of 65 watts. Stepping up a bit in AMD's retail lineup brings you to the Ryzen 5 3600, which gives you a lot more processing power, but its price is quite a bit higher too. While there doesn't seem to be all that much separating the 3300X from the 3100, other than a 20% higher price and better clock speeds, there's a bit more going on here too. AMD has actually laid both of these out very differently. While the 3100's 4 cores and cache are spread across 2 different CCX modules, the 3300Xs are clustered into one. That basically cuts down on latency since communications don't happen over the Infinity Fabric, and technically that should also lead to more better overall performance. As for competitive performance, this is what AMD sent out, but like I said before, this is already outdated since Intel's 9th-gen CPUs will be replaced with the new 10th-gen parts in just a few weeks. Either way, right now the i3-9100F retails for about $75, while the i5-9400F has finally leveled off to about $150. So the Ryzen 3 3300X and 3100 are competing against, well, neither. You see, that's where the i3-10100 comes into things, because unlike the i5-9400's 6 threads and the i3-9100's 4, it has 8 threads, which matches the new Ryzen's, and it's supposed to cost just a few bucks more than the 3300X. Now, Intel might still be fighting an uphill battle here, since the stock heatsink is absolute trash compared to the Ryzen 3's Wraith-style cooler, and the i3 might not be quite that efficient in real-world testing. But this is definitely going to be an interesting fight in the $100 to $150 market. Now, onto benchmarks, and in the charts, you'll see a few interesting additions. Those would be the 1300X and the 1600AF. For those of you who may not know the Ryzen 5 1600AF, it's a 12-nanometer refresh of the original 1600 that operates at a lower 65-watt TDP and higher clocks. Originally, it was priced at around $85, but recently that shot up quite a bit. Either way, if you can find it under 100 bucks, it might be the best value upgrade for someone using a Ryzen 3 1200 or a 1300X. Now, as we go through these tests, it's really amazing to see how far AMD has come since the first generation Ryzen 3 CPUs. They're now offering 8 processing threads on super affordable CPUs, along with higher clock speeds, and that makes a huge impact on overall performance. Now, would I use any of these processors you're seeing on these charts for hardcore professional work? Absolutely, positively not, but for some light productivity through Excel, photo editing, and even rendering static scenes in Blender, or program compiling tasks, they tend to compete really well with the more expensive Intel 9400F in lightly threaded workloads, and they walk all over the place in multi-threaded applications. The only thing I want to point out in Adobe Premiere is that without an integrated GPU, the 9400F really has to rely on its processing horsepower, or its lack of power, to be honest. That really does hurt it. But Resolve shows something completely different, which is a complete logjam. This program really benefits from a super powerful graphics card, and that'll become a bottleneck long before the CPU. So if you're like us, rendering YouTube videos on DaVinci Resolve all the time, you're actually much better off maxing out your budget on a super fast GPU than spending a fortune on a processor. Now, moving on to gaming, and honestly, any of these new processors would be a pretty good fit and a massive upgrade for someone with a 1300X. Now, sure, the 1600 AF doesn't have all the optimizations rolled into more recent revisions of Zen architecture, but it still provides a good mix of price and performance for first-gen buyers who don't want to upgrade their motherboards just yet. Also, make sure you remember that we're using a super powerful RTX 2080 Ti here in order to show if there's really any differences where the GPU doesn't provide a bottleneck. So that means with a lower end card, the gap between these CPUs would narrow even more. Power consumption is pretty much as expected since the 7nm Zen 2 architecture is super efficient, and that shows here, but it will be really interesting to see how the new Intel 10th gen stacks up here since they are still on the ancient 14nm plus 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 node. Well, there you have it, guys. And I have to say, both these CPUs are really, really impressive. I mean, it's amazing to see the $100 Ryzen 3 3100 either matching or beating the $150 Core i5-9400F in literally every test. Now, as for the 3300X, that just takes overall value to the next level. And if I were to choose between the two CPUs, I think spending the extra $20 on the 3300X is money well spent, because in some cases it actually has better lightly threaded performance compared to the Ryzen 5 3600. The problem here is that our benchmarks only tell the story that AMD wants you to see right now, and that causes a lot of unknowns. You see, with the availability of these new Ryzen 3 CPUs at retailers, the new B550 motherboards launch, along with Intel's 10th gen Comet Lake rolled out over the next 45 days, it's very difficult to recommend anything right now until we paint the whole picture. And that does mean that all of these performance results would be outdated by then. So, yeah. Look, if you have the money to upgrade from a first-gen Ryzen 3 or Kaby Lake-based i3 CPU and have the cash for a new CPU and motherboard, waiting a few weeks isn't a big deal. By then, everyone will know how these new Ryzen 3 CPUs align with Intel's 10th-gen i3s, and then you can make more of an educated jump. But if you're already on the first-gen Ryzen 3 ecosystem, and if you don't have $200 or more to spend on a complete system overhaul, and if you don't care about PCIe Gen 4, there is a perfect solution. Provided you can actually find one for $100, the Ryzen 5 1600 AF is a ridiculously good drop-in solution because it gets you more processing performance over your existing CPU setup, which is Ryzen 3, of course. So on that note, thank you so much for watching. I hope you guys are informed about these performance of these new processors. Again, this is all gonna get updated very soon once Intel gets into the mix. So until then, stay safe, spend responsibly, and I'll talk to you guys in the next one.